Welcome back to Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today we are here speaking with Lisa Batiashvili, a brilliant Georgian violinist. And we left off talking about her first days in Munich studying violin with
Anna Chumachenko.
Why is she so good?
I found contact with her always so much more than just partnership within music, but she's always been someone that you could talk about all sorts of things in life, and it just is incredibly, it's such an amazing thing to have a person like this in your life, because you know that she has so much experience. She has had contact with also sort of great legendary musicians. She studied with Joseph Sigeti and Yehudi Menuhin, with Sandor Weck. So all styles of music is she feels really at home with, because it's just really the experience and the contact that she has had in her life.
How long did you study with her?
6 years.
Mm-hmm. What came after that?
Well, during these 6 years, actually in the first year of the study with her, I participated in the Sibelius competition. That was the first thing I started, and was just learning repertoire for that competition. It's always good to actually propose young students to participate in competitions, not in order to win or to make career, but in order to give them some sort of motivation, clear motivation to practice, to learn repertoire. So that was the main kind of goal. But then I became second at this competition as the youngest competitor, and got to play quite a lot of concerts already at that age of 16, 17, mostly in Scandinavia, but that was already kind of a very active time. So after finishing my studies, I continued playing my concerts, and soon after that, actually, I met my husband and had children. So it was just a combination of two lives.
Where did you... met your husband?
Well, we met in Munich because he was a principal oboist of the Bavarian Radio Symphony Orchestra at that time. He's French, but he also chose Munich as his home. Mm. And it was very funny because basically both of us had decided to live in Munich and found each other. And it was such an incredibly obvious thing to kind of get settled there. And so then the kids came. In our country, Georgia, women have kids quite early, like, in 20s. Mm-hmm. So that was never a question of not having children in order to play more concerts or so. So that was quite a clear plan.
How old are the children now?
They are 12 and 8. So it's...
Are they musical?
They're musical, yeah. They like music, but they like many other things as well.
Uh-huh,
and
uh-huh.
I like the fact that they like other things as well, because I didn't have chance to do as many other activities because of the music, and I spend most of my free time after school with music. And now with the new generation, everything changes,
right.
And it's quite fun to watch how kids are interested in all sorts of things and how they're also searching for their passion.
Do you think one of your kid will follow you?
I don't think will follow me or father, because none of them play our instruments.
Oh, really?
They play piano and flute. I don't know. And I really am not sure they should do the same thing, because it's such an individual thing. It's, of course, certain knowledge of music and talent may be inherited from parents, but it's not enough to actually make...
Right.
Make it as your own life, and
they have to have the passion.
They have to have the passion. They really should want to actually spend time with the instrument every day, because nobody can play without practicing, and that's a big issue. Because I think either the kid does it by himself, or it needs a parent that is there all the time and, make sure that the kid practices. And music making, just like a hobby, is possible. But as soon as you want a serious and good results, you have to really sit or stand and practice. And this is a little bit a little bit difficult.
So that's what you're going to tell other parents? Don't force them, or
No, it's not the force. But if you feel that the kid is really talented and really loves the instrument, then you have to make sure the kid practices, because it might get to a moment where it's 15 or 16 years old and just would love to become a musician, but missed all these years of practicing, which you cannot actually really do afterwards. You have to get some work done when you're a kid. And it's very important. And that's why, for example, in those, you know, maybe also today, there were years where in the Soviet school, for example, there was much more of strict way of education. And, you know, every child who took an instrument took it seriously and practiced. Of course, this is not, I wouldn't say this is the right thing to do. But if you want to become a musician, then you have to also be aware of that. And it's like being a sportsman almost.
What's it like, you know, parents, both are musicians? I mean, you know, husband and wife. Do you talk about music all the time at home, or?
Not all the time. We talk about it time to time when we need to, and I really like his advice, and, you know, it's so fulfilling because my husband knows so much about music. He's also conducting, and he's a chamber musician. He's been orchestral musician. He's a soloist, and for me, it's a fantastic musical personality that I can talk to.
About the balance that you have to find between your life as a concert violinist and your family life, how do you deal with it? And do you do it by, I only do so many concerts a year, or do you find certain months that you say, no, that is family time? How do you deal with it?
Yeah, I don't do too many concerts. I am quite aware about how many days I want to be away in a month. And this is what is probably, you know, the only way to actually control it somehow. Otherwise, if you say yes to everything that comes, then you are just not there. And for me, it's completely out of question to be away more than 10 to 14 days a month. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's even less. And these are the months actually where the life at home is kind of the most settled. And I'm encouraging my husband to do the same a little bit. For men, it's a little bit more difficult because it's kind of not this similar feeling of, you know, it's very hard to say what the difference is actually, because he's such a wonderful father and husband. But the relationship to the work for men is even closer. I think it's even more intense. For us, for women, we can really divide these two things and
really
understand. Yeah, for me, it's really very clear that if I'm not there, then it's not possible. I want to be. I want to see my kids grow up, and I want to be involved in their life and to not to miss out things, because why should I? And at the same time, of course, I need to travel, and they have to get used to the fact that I'm not there all the time. But they can call me anytime, and we can discuss. And so this is what we both do, actually, and try to actually avoid work at the same time. And we get help from our parents as well, which is wonderful.
So, your parents are now in Munich?
They are in Germany,
So what was your first, what would you call your first major breakthrough on the concert stage?
Well, there was this one year where it was not the breakthrough, probably it was a little bit after that, but which was a very important year. And it was when my daughter was born, and I had my debut in the same year with Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra and with the New York Philharmonic. And it was a very tough time because my baby was born, and I knew that I had to start playing again quite, you know, only a couple of weeks after the birth. And I hesitated a lot, and I thought about it, whether I should really do it or take a break and, like an every normal mother, just stay with a kid and, you know, forget about work for a while. But I forced myself to actually continue playing, and did the two debuts, which became two major, let's say, musical relationships in my life with these two orchestras. Had I missed them out, maybe next opportunity would have been much later or in a different way. At the same time, I did regret that I didn't have more time with my daughter. So again, you have a situation like that where you don't know what's the right thing to do, but you make a decision, and it's good for one thing. But of course, ideally, you know, you need time with your child when it's born, and it's something that I'm not sure whether that was really the right thing to do. But for my musical career, certainly that was the most important moment.
It must be a struggle. You love your child, but in the same time, you love your career too. I mean, in the same time, how do you really try to balance them out? That is a struggle, isn't it?
The beginning is very hard because it's a new situation which you just don't know how to deal with. After a while, you start working it out because you are kind of more experienced. Every day, you are kind of trying to figure out how much you can do. And clearly, if I had dropped everything, maybe I would not have been happier than today, because something, you know, I would have missed out a very important part of my life and what I really love doing. And this struggle, I'm sure it's part of every woman's life who is working and who is especially traveling with the work. We just have to try to make it work so that we can actually take advantage of the both sides, because we get inspired from life for the music, but we also get inspired from music for the life. We live differently when we have music in our life.
Right, sure.
I'm completely sure about it. And for a musician's life is so unique and so inspired and so full of fantasy and motivation. Mm-hmm. I think that would be shame to let go and just, you know, have a everyday same thing happening in your life.
How about added two words, romantic and beautiful?
Romantic, beautiful, but also very challenging.
Sure.
Which keeps you always up.
Oh, definitely.
You're always alert and always trying to make things better. And I think every human being needs that in order to keep the energy going.
Speaking of this, let's have some music. I think it's time to listen to some music. comes to mind Dvorak Violin Concerto. We'll listen to a clip of Dvorak. And Dvorak was in a very special place. Can you tell us where that was?
Yes. This is one of the most amazing places in Europe. It's in Berlin, called Waldbühne, a wonderful place where lots of concerts are happening, not only classical concerts, but also pop and rock, jazz concerts. The Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra have, each year they actually have a concert there in summer. And luckily I was invited to join them this year with Czech program. I played Dvořák Violin Concerto with amazing Janik Nizesigan, who is also a close friend and just a just a phenomenon in in classical music.
It's a wonderful thing, though. I feel all the critics' review is all wonderful. Your quality, silky sound and everything. Now, it must be there are moments you feel not so good about it. You have to struggle with yourself. Mm. Even outside, everything is so perfect.
Mm. Oh, that happens to me so often.
And I mean, how do you deal with it?
I know it's this way, and I know myself already. I think no critic can actually save me if I am not confident and I'm not happy about what I'm doing. And I'm the first critic of myself, and I think I'm very often over self-critical and kind of almost destroying myself with that, because my imagination of what I actually imagine as a ideal performance is so far away from from what I can deliver, that it is always there. It happens to me maybe 5 times a year that I'm happy with my performance.
After the performance, do you replay it in your mind? Like tonight, will you, the whole concert this afternoon, will it go through your mind again or not?
Certain spots, yeah. Maybe not the whole concerto, but things that I want to do better or different tomorrow. It's all the time in my ears.
But also things that you really nailed and that you got well, you think of those too, right?
No, unfortunately. I'm a very kind of, it may be also connected to this Soviet school where the teachers have been so strict. I haven't really experienced that myself, but genetically I've inherited it, I think, because I'm so much a strict kind of teacher to myself that I want better. And if something doesn't go as good, then I'm really bad to myself, you know, psychologically. So maybe this is also something that kind of motivates me to never stop learning and growing in some ways. But it's also important to enjoy. When I play with great orchestras and conductors, of course, I do also get a lot of energy back on the stage.
Do you think ever, at a certain point in your career, that every performance, okay, it's fine, it's great, just next one, so not to worry about whatever you did?
I always worry about what I do. It's my character. It's funny because we are understanding how important it is to us at some point. It's, even though it's not about us, it's about music. But I think it's more about the fact that I put so much into the work, so much time and thoughts and all my energy that I want it to be as good as possible. Of course, the difference might be very tiny between what people hear, you know, but still for me it's very important that I deliver what I wanted to deliver.
You have a new CD coming out. Tell us about it.
Yes, the new CD with a great Daniel Barenboim conducting Staatskapelle Berlin. We have recorded Tchaikovsky and Sibelius concertos. Tchaikovsky because I learned Tchaikovsky concerto in order to play with him. That was particularly, I had never played it as a child or as a student. And then he wanted to record that together with Sibelius because he had heard me play Sibelius on television years ago. And he said, I always wanted to play with you, Sibelius, so let's just put them together and record. And that was quite an experience.
It's wonderful.
Of those great violin concertos, you name them better than I can, but do you have one that if someone says, will you play that, are you the happiest if someone says, oh, I'm so excited I get to play Beethoven again or Brahms or...
Yeah, any of them.
Any of them.
I think these are just such masterworks that, you know, they have all their special place in my heart, in my mind, and it can, you know, Beethoven, for example, I've played so much in my student years, also later with the big debuts I made with the Beethoven Concerto. Now it's been almost 5 years I haven't played it anymore. So next season I will be playing it again, and it's almost like a new piece again. You know, I've missed it so much.
It's like returning to an old friend.
Yes, and of course we are very lucky violinists. We have such great repertoire, and we never get bored.
Do you have a reference? I mean, preference to play with the orchestra or chamber or something?
Chamber music, you mean? Well, 80% of my concerts are with orchestras. Mm. So it's something that I'm more used to. I feel maybe more comfortable. But I do play also chamber music with really wonderful people project-wise. And it's really, you know, I was raised with this music, as I said, the string quartet. So it will always remain for me very, very important to play chamber music with people who actually also inspire me, who I learn from, and I learn and practice to listen to other people so much. Because as a soloist, it's a completely different experience still.
You work with the different conductors, and do you change the way you play? Deal with the different conductors?
I must say some conductors who have really great personality, they influence me mm-hmm. in their own way.
Right.
And that the change happens because what they give is something so magnetic and so incredibly strong that then I sometimes surprise myself that I do things in music or I can express something that I wasn't aware of doing it. For example, Yannick Nézet-Séguin, because he just, everything he does, it's so musically inspired. He makes music with each of his movements with his hands. So he inspires me as a soloist a lot. Another matter like this was, for example, also with Christian Thielemann, who I played Brahms Concerto with, I recorded with him. It was an incredible feeling. Suddenly, something happened on stage that, you know, I had never even thought of playing this way before.
Well, one time I was reading something, and you say, oh, this is a man's piece. What does that mean? That because the size of a hand or what?
I think that Brahms is very difficult for small hands.
Yeah, right.
Like Rachmaninoff for the pianist.
Yeah, sure.
It took me a long time to learn how to play certain spots in the violin concerto, and I had to kind of really work on stretching my fingers, and that was for me clear that for big hands it was much more obvious.
Are there any of these standard repertoire violin pieces out there that you have not played yet that you're saying, I must play this piece? Any that you haven't played?
I haven't played the Bruch Violin Concerto, but I don't think that I must play it. I might play it one day, but it's No, I think I had an issue with Bruch and Tchaikovsky. Now with the Tchaikovsky, it's over. Mm-hmm. That everybody played these two pieces, like since I remember myself, it's been always Bruch and Tchaikovsky. So I basically avoided these two pieces, started from other concertos and then went to the repertoire of the 20th century, some also new works and Baroque and everything. And then I came back to Tchaikovsky because I think it's a phenomenal concerto. It's great music. And I will be learning also other repertoire. Of course, there are a couple of concertos like Szymanowski No. 1, which is my next piece for the next season to play. But I really think that one should play concertos that one gets inspired from, especially in my age. I don't have to play one or the other work. I want to play what I really want to play.
Right. Now, what do you think for the younger generation? What would you say to them?
To the musicians?
That's right.
Well, I think take your time, first of all. No reason to hurry up for certain things. Of course, we're living in a different time now. But take advantage of possibilities. We can travel, listen to each other, to other orchestras around the world, to soloists, to attend master classes, everything. It's, I think, the best time now to do experiences like that, to experience all sorts of different cultures and and just believe in what you're doing and believe in and be honest to the music. I think the honesty is something that has to remain always there. It doesn't matter what other people do, but I think what I'm doing with the music, I have to feel that everything I'm doing, it comes from my heart. And that is something to
think
about.
That's your voice.
Yes.
Yes. And that's a very, very good note to end on. Unfortunately, we're out of time, but it's been a real pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for coming to us and chatting with us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's a great pleasure. Thanks.
This has been Classic Talk with Bing and Dennis. Today, we've been speaking with Lisa Batiashvili.